All right, our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Acts. This is not a lectionary text, so if you're a lectionary reader and you're like, hey, he's not where he belongs, well, maybe. I hope I'm where I belong, but I may not be a lectionary text. Let me set this text in context. Jesus has ascended. The disciples have waited the 10 days in Jerusalem. Pentecost has happened, and they are out preaching the gospel, and crazy things are happening. God is doing amazing work in the early days of the church. The church, if you will, is literally only days old when this text is composed. Acts 2, 42 to 47. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with gladness and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You perhaps were with us last Sunday when we spent some time after lunch. We did a 3 and lunch after our All Saints Day service, and we began to talk about this concept of why versus what. The what of what the church does versus the why of what the church does, and how those really are two really different things. And when we understand the why, the what becomes so much more impactful. I want to talk about that also in the context of Veterans Day. Today's Veterans Day, and this is the what of veterans. Battles. And back in the day, it was often seen as skirmish lines. It was seen as cannon fire and battleship, broadside, and battleship. This is the what the military did, engaged in battle. In World War II, it looked like the Normandy invasion. And men in open-top boats being riddled with bullets from the hills and left bleeding and dying all over the beach. The water littered with dead bodies. The what of the military during Vietnam looked like Chinook helicopters dropping in supplies and warfare changing some. Of course, they didn't have helicopters back in the Revolutionary War, and they weren't as common in World War II as we saw them in Nam. But the what of warfare has changed over time. It has gone from being mainly men with guns and bayonets to machinery. To weapons that are unmanned. But all in all, the why of the military has not changed. Battle has changed. The way warfare is conducted has changed. That's the what. But the why has not changed. The why for the military is still about freedom. And when we understand that that's the driving force of the military to preserve freedom, then the what is allowed to change. I think the military has figured out that it's really not about doing hand-to-hand combat with people. It's about taking out systems. And so now they have smart weapons and drones. They have GPS and laser-guided ordnance that very precisely goes in and takes out targets. And those targets are often command and control, and systems that then cripple that nation so that freedom can be brought to bear. In some ways, I guess our military is a smarter military. I was amazed when my nephew was in the Air Force, and he was on the front lines of the battle, but he was in Las Vegas, Nevada. And the battle was happening in Iraq. But he was on the front lines because he sat next to the guy flying the drone and he did everything else. And from Las Vegas, Nevada, they were conducting a battle on the other side of the globe. Interesting thing is, when he got out of the Air Force, he went to work as a private contractor for a company, and they put him in Afghanistan. It's like our military is learning that we don't always have to be face-to-face with the enemy, so to speak, and literally across the skirmish line to have an effect, to still preserve freedom. The what of the military has changed. The why has not changed. Which brings us to a video that I wanted to show last Sunday afternoon and was not able to, and so I wanted to show it to you today because this comedian, Michael Jr., helps us to understand the difference between what we do and why we do it. And he does it probably more eloquently in a few minutes than I could ever articulate. Listen to what he says.
How do I know? A lot of people, when they think of the phrase, how do I know, they always want to put the what behind it. How do I know what I'm supposed to do? The question that you really should ask is, how do I know why I'm here? Because when you know your why, your what becomes more clear and more impactful. If you know, like for instance, people know that I'm in comedy, but that's what I do. My why is to inspire people to walk in purpose. So I can do comedy, I can write books, I can be in a movie, because all of it is motivated by my why. In fact, I have a new web series out called Michael Jr. Break Time. We probably just did the 6th episode. It's on YouTube. So every single Wednesday at 3 o'clock, we drop a new episode on YouTube of Michael Jr. Break Time. What it is it's me. I travel around the country and I do stand-up comedy, get you to know. And in the middle of my comedy set sometime, I'll stop and just talk to my audience. And we've been filming this, and it's pretty cool. So we're in Winston-Salem. I'm going to show you a clip from Winston-Salem. And I'm just talking to this guy in the audience, and he tells me that he's a musical instructor at a school. So I was like, all right, you're a musical instructor. You know, can you sing? Let me hear you sing a song. So this is what happened at the last episode of Michael Jr.'s Break Time. Check it. So you're a musical director?
Yes, sir.
All right, so let me get a couple bars of, like, Amazing Grace. Can you do the first part of that? Go ahead.
Because you're walking into your purpose. to raise a question. That Navy is really messed up in Ann. Sorry about that. I don't know what happened there. How does that affect us personally and as a church? Think about personally. Not what you do, but why you do it. What is it that is driving the what in your life? What is it that gets you up every morning and gets you down the road? Now, it may be something positive that you do, and you say, why do I do that? Or something negative that you do. You say, why do I keep doing that? If you can figure out the why, you can sometimes adjust the what. Oftentimes, when I'm spending time with people, especially in my office doing counseling, we begin to talk about the why. This is especially true in premarital counseling. I have a survey that I give couples. It's called Prepare and Enrich. It's about 200 questions, and they fill out this survey, and I get the results back, and we sit down, and we start to talk. And I'll say to them, I'll say, boy, you know, it's pretty clear from the survey that when you guys go out to dinner, and this is often the case, the guy in the relationship will say to the girl, where do you want to go for dinner? And she will say, I don't know. Or I don't care. And he always has to pick. Now sometimes it's just flipped, I know. Sometimes the girl's the decider and the guy has no idea. And they have no idea why they do that. They just know it's what they do. One of the couple always picks where they go to dinner. And the other one never seems to pick. Which is really interesting because from the survey results, I can tell them right away why they do that. I said, well, if you look here, it says that one of you is far more into avoidance, often they're into avoiding conflict, and one of you is far more assertive than the other. In fact, the one that's not assertive is also a bit introverted. And so you're kind of all in your head as an introvert, and you don't really like to confront people. You're not very certain, you're not very good at saying, this is what I want. And so you're never willing to pick them. And they go, oh. And then I always give the sign. If it's the guy who's more assertive and is always picking the rest, I say, here's your deal. On occasion, when you have time and it's not in the middle of a fight, your job is to pull into an empty parking lot with a car and put it in park. And say, we will move when you decide where we're going to dinner. And it will be uncomfortable. But you need to do it. Because you need to help your spouse to be more assertive. You need to help your spouse to be able to make a simple decision of where we want to go to dinner tonight. Part of that then translates into the rest of life. If I can be assertive on where I want to go for dinner, I can also be assertive on the boundaries in my life. I can be assertive about what I want out of life. And it can help. If we understand the why behind what we do, then we can begin to understand what's going on in our lives. Jesus was like this. Let me unpack this for a moment before we get to the Acts text. If you recall, most of us say Jesus came to earth to save the world. Amen? Okay. If that was Jesus' only purpose, when Satan said to him, if you will bow down and worship me, I will give you all the kingdoms of the world. Which was exactly why many of us believe Christ came. Why didn't he say yes? He didn't say yes because the other part of why he was here was to bring glory to the Father. See, Jesus was here for two purposes. Bring glory to the Father and save the world. Satan was only offering him one of those. Saving the world. And to get it the way Satan wanted him to get it, he would have to not bring glory to the Father. And Jesus said no. Because he knew why he was here. Did that look attractive to him? Absolutely. It was a temptation. It meant avoiding the cross, avoiding the pain, avoiding the separation from God. That all looked very attractive. But he knew why he was here. And the why forced him to say no to the what of Satan's temptation. Okay, so let's talk about church. In Acts 2, we hear what's going on in the church. Not this church, of course. We hear what's going on in the early church. Now, if you listened to what was happening, you say, wow, that was kind of different. They were devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to breaking of bread, and to prayer. That part's not different. We do that today. But what they did was different in the fact that everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and everything in common. They're selling their property. They're giving to the poor. They're living in community, and they're worshiping in the temple court every day. That's the what of what to do. We don't still do that, do we? We don't still live in community in the sense that if I have property, I give it, and you give yours, and we all only have exactly what we need, and everything's held in community. They stopped that at some point in the history of the church. And we don't spend time in the temple court every day. My guess is some of you are going to go to work tomorrow, especially if you want to feed your family. Even those of you who are retired do not spend time every day in church. Why did we change what we do? Well, because our why is what drives us as a church, as a community of faith. And the why of what we do, quite honestly, people, comes from here. Matthew 28:19-20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing and teaching. As Jesus is ascending, this is the thing he tells the disciples to do. This is to be the overarching guiding principle. This is to be the why of what we do as a church. Make disciples. Sometimes, you know, the church gets it right. In the mid-90s, the United Methodist Church changed their mission statement. It used to be a paragraph long. It was cumbersome, it was difficult, and nobody knew what it was. And they changed it based on this passage of Scripture to one simple line. The mission of the United Methodist Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, period. Now, next line says the local church is the best place for that to happen. Not the annual conference center, not a general conference every 4 years. This is where that's happening. But the why of what we're supposed to be about is making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. If that's our why, then our what can be adjusted accordingly. How is Sacred Time United Methodist Church going to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world is vastly different than how they're going to do that in Hawaii, perhaps. You know, in Hawaii, they don't have the problem of, we're going to have to worship inside in the wintertime. You know, they have churches with no walls. They don't have to budget for HVAC like we do. They don't have to budget for snow removal like we do. A church in Florida doesn't have the same budget constraints as a church in Northwest Pennsylvania because of weather. The what can change, but the why is still the same. The why of what we do is making disciples. And when we get a hold of that, it can change. It can change us in the sense that we let go of things we don't need to hold on to, and we get excited about new things. As a kid growing up, there were certain things that were done at Nixon United Methodist Church. You know, we always did it that way. They were what's. They weren't why's. And maybe there's some things that happen here at Sacred Time United Methodist Church that you say, you know, we've always done it that way. But is it a what? Or is it a why? This church has a history of disciple making. Sometimes it's not real clearly articulated, but you folks have an incredible history of making disciples. If you didn't, this expansion would have never happened in 1995. Because you guys understood the why of ministry. It's about making disciples. It's not about keeping the congregation happy. It's not about doing the same thing every week. It's about doing whatever it takes to reach out and connect with new people. That's why about 15 years ago, you started a third service, a praise service. It went over top of Sunday school, which made Sunday school kind of hard. But you did it because there was a congregation that needed invited into the church who weren't here at the time. A congregation that would enjoy that style of worship. You see, style is a what? It's not a why. So you're free to enjoy contemporary, to enjoy traditional, to enjoy blended, because that's not a lie, that's a what? And in your life, you may change. And when you're younger, you may like more contemporary stuff. You know, when you get to be John's age, you may start switching into the traditional stuff. In our church, we're striving to be about why, not what. So we continue to ask questions. How are we going to function to help this happen? Let me explain this illustration if you haven't seen it before. This is a wonderful illustration of people encountering a notion, a picture, but encountering the gospel. Some people stand here on the beach and simply look at the gospel represented by the water. They simply look at spirituality and in connection with Christ, the life in Christ, and it's just kind of, they look off and say, well, that's kind of interesting, but they stay on the beach. Some people begin to dabble. They just want to feel the water. They don't want to get wet. Maybe you've been to the beach, you've been like this. Every time the wave rolls in, you run backwards instead of forward. Some people are willing to get in and wave. First of all, let me say, for those of you who are temperature sensitive, let's assume for a moment that the water is just the right temperature. Some of you have been to Prescott, you know. It looks so inviting, and then you touch the water, you're like, forget that, that's cold. I get that. Some people along the line decide, you know what, I'm not content just to be wet up to my waist. I want to get in there, and I want to float in this ocean of Christ's love, and I want to feel His support me. And some people say, that's not even enough for me. I want to get in there and I want to swim. I'm going to get my head under the water and I want to see what's below the surface. And other people say, I am all in. I want to plumb the depths. See, this guy doesn't know about the dolphin. He doesn't know about the school of fish. But this scuba diver does, because he has plumbed the depths. In our conversation today, this is the path of a disciple. We all, at some point in our life, are standing on the beach, amen? You may have been so young, you don't remember beach time. You were raised in the church. And for you, you've always been a part of the church. From the time you were born, you're like children in the congregation. You've always been out here dabbling in the water. Now, granted, you know, when you're that age, you hang out in the shallows. And over time, you said, Lord, I'm not content with just my knees. I want to get into this. I want to know what it is to completely fall in love with you, Father. I want my life to be all about what you're doing. And our discipleship, hopefully, as we get older, gets deeper and deeper until at some point in our life is directed by the why of who we are as a faithful Christian. And our Christianity is not about what we do on Sunday morning. Our Christianity is who we are. And whether you are at work, whether you're around the Thanksgiving table, whether you're on vacation, it's all about the why of following Christ. Some of us, quite honestly, kind of hang out here, because that's where we were as a kid, and we kind of graduated high school out of this area someplace, and you know, we just stayed there. Our life is very compartmentalized. We have our work world, we have our family world, we have our church world, we have our vacation world, we have our fun world, we have our hobby world. I'm preaching to some of the guys now, aren't I? Because we tend to be very compartmentalized. And they never mix. This guy mixes everything, doesn't he? All of life is about plumbing the depths of God. This one image has done so much to help me solidify in my mind why we do what we do. Because you see, what this image tells me is, as a congregation, the what of what we do, if we're going to make disciples for Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, we have to have programs that talk to this guy. And we have to have programs that talk to this guy. And everything in between. Sunday school for children? Yeah, it's up in this area. Sunday school for adults needs to be out in here. Bible study for adults needs to be out in here. Trunk or treat? We're way back here. Thanksgiving dinner, free to the whole community? It's way back here. But if we don't catch them here, we're never going to get them here, are we? We can't catch them in the water, folks, if we don't introduce them to the ocean. And how do come for dinner on the Sunday before Thanksgiving, no strings attached. Why? Because we want you to experience radical love. Love that doesn't say, I love you if. I love you because you were good today. I'll serve you dinner, but there's a cost. No. We want people to stand here and say, my gosh, this looks so inviting. Because hopefully we're out here going, man, you think this is good standing on the beach? Wait till you get under the surface. Holy cow! That's when we get to transform the world for Christ. That's when people begin to experience abundant life. That's what the church is about. So I guess I have two questions for you. One, where are you on the continuum? Can you find yourself? Can you place yourself someplace along this continuum of discipleship? John Wesley said that we're always growing. See, for John Wesley, when he talks about grace, he talks about prevenient grace, justifying grace, sanctifying grace. You've heard me use those words. Prevenient grace is when we're standing on the beach and we're experiencing God's grace nudging us towards the water. We don't even know what we need, and God's nudging us. And then at some point, we step in. And that's the moment in which we say, God, I have no idea how deep this is. I have no idea what this is going to feel like. But I'm going to step off, and I'm going to trust you. God saved me. God says, you are saved. You are justified. If you die this moment, as Billy Graham would ask, you're going to heaven. But then God loves us enough to not leave us there. And John Wesley says, from the moment we step into the water, for the rest of our lives, we're journeying. And the goal is that we keep getting deeper and deeper and deeper. And we plumb the depths. That sanctifying grace, that is turning over a piece of our life, piece by piece, to God. And that includes turning over the why of our life. The why of our life all of a sudden becomes what Scripture calls us to. Not what culture calls us to. It becomes about serving God and honoring Him, not about making sure we have enough toys and enough money. It's about saying, God, I want to do your will, not mine. I want to live into your call, not mine. I want to know why I'm here, God. I want to have a purpose so that everything I do drives towards that purpose. Like the guy saying, Amazing Grace. Not just doing something, knowing the what, but knowing the why. How we live. My prayer for you this day is that you will take at least a moment this week and ask yourself some really hard questions. Why do I get up every morning? What drives me? Is it just to see if I can get through another day? Or is it really about getting deep with God? Is it really about becoming completely immersed in His love? And allowing Him to carry me out into the deep and to show me amazing new things I've never seen. One funny story about the depths. When I was a high school senior, my parents loaded me up in a camper and took me to Florida. First time in my life I went to Florida. By the way, I got out, felt the grass, and thought it was fake. It was the weirdest grass I'd ever seen. My Uncle Charles had a beer yard. It was real grass, but I'd never seen Florida. On that trip, we went and saw my cousin Bill. And my cousin Bill put us in a boat and took us 7 miles out into the ocean. In the boat, all you can see is water, 360 degrees, which made my mother instantly sick. So she is eating the fish. You know what I mean? We all jumped in the water, and Bill said, I want to show you something. And we swam out a little ways from the boat and ducked under the waves, and there, 7 miles out, it was only about 20 feet deep water. And on the floor of the ocean was this huge statue of Christ standing like this. From the boat, you couldn't see a thing. But once you got below the waves, you could see the glory of God. I thought, how many people are zipping across the water here, but they have no idea what's underneath the surface? They have no idea the statue's here. You wouldn't know unless you got out, got in the water, got wet. My mom didn't see it. Why? She was busy feeding the fish. She had no idea what was under the surface. I think she was. choice, but she was busy being sick. My mom could get sick if you sat down on the edge of the bed. Why, she thought a boat ride 7 miles out in the ocean was a good idea.
No idea.
I was 18 at the time, I was clueless. I hope today you desire to go deep, to get out of the shallows, to stop being in control, and say to God, God, I want your why to drive me every day of my life. Let's pray. Father, if we were honest, much of our life is driven by forces that we do not understand. The why that drives what we do, Father, is so often difficult for us to discern. But you completely understand. So I pray this day, Father, that you would open our eyes and reveal to us a little bit of the why. Why we get frustrated so easily. Why we lash out. Why we're happy all the time. Why we're eager to get up in the morning. Why we're anxious about the holidays. Why the children bring such joy to our lives. Help us to look hard, Father, and find the why of life. And help us as a church to look hard to make sure that our what being driven by our Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name.